Welcome to Fox College Football, sponsored by GEICO. And welcome to Oklahoma Memorial Stadium in its 100th season of use, and a place that they typically don't get to introduce new college football head coaches very often. But today is almost a coronation, certainly a celebration here in Norman. Jason Benetti, Brock Huard along with you, and Brent Venables in his first game as the head coach here, a former assistant. He's back home, he feels like.
Well, based on the crowd today, a lot of cheers for a lot of returning Sooners, but the loudest was reserved for the 51-year-old who's waited a long time to be the guy. And based on yesterday's emotion and energy as he met with us, what we watched in pregame, the jumping jacks with his team, this place is jumping. College football's jumping. They want to see what a Brent Venables-led team looks like, and I can't wait for it.
He is literally in the middle of it right here today, and he's got a new quarterback, Dylan Gabriel. He will lead this team out to this field to an absolutely thunderous roar. Gabriel here from UCF to take over at quarterback.
And a little bit different than Brent because Jeff Lebby follows him. Those two have known each other a long time, a special relationship. In today's college football, Jason, you need an advocate. You need someone that believes in you and trusts in you. Lebby does, and that's why it may look different defensively today, but with him slinging it and the shots that he's going to take down the field, I expect a bunch of points for the Sooners too.
Lebby told us, I had to have that kid. UTEP comes in at 0-1. They've played once. Dana Dimble, the head coach, has beaten Oklahoma 9 times on a staff at Kansas State. He's familiar with the scene. He's familiar with the smoke in the air and the humidity, and we'll see how much that means. We'll take you to break with our Progressive Insurance game countdown as the UTEP Miners are set to take on the 9th-ranked Oklahoma Sooners. Kickoff is next. When we talked to Dana Dimble and walked through yesterday, as we welcome you back to Fox College Football, sponsored by GEICO, he said, at least it won't be humid on the field, and he's right. But it is, however, 96 degrees.
It doesn't bother the guys. Remember, they play in the Sun Bowl. So the sunshine shouldn't bother him. He does love the fact that it is a little lower humidity, and that guy's won the toss. Defensive minded head coach, right? You kick? Nope. You're going to put that high powered offense right on the field.
He told us yesterday, Brent Venables, that he is at his best when he's grinding. And we'll see what that looks like on the sideline today after coaching in a total of 8 national championships, including in year 2 here at Oklahoma back in 2000. A new era of Sooner football is just about underway. Gavin Beckley's foot will start it here in Norman. The Brent Venables era has dawned, and the opening kickoff leads to a touchback. We told you a little bit about Dylan Gabriel. He is a redshirt junior out of Mililani on Oahu who broke all sorts of records from Tua and Mackenzie Milton in Hawaii. 70 touchdowns, 14 interceptions, a sleek quarterback. He makes quick decisions. And last year, a broken clavicle shortened his season at UCF to 3 games.
Super quick eyes. Silky smooth delivery and fundamentals for young quarterbacks watching today. This is a guy to emulate as good as anyone.
On play action, Gabriel's first throw down the field for a shot, incomplete for Marvin Mims, their deep threat. And here is the Oklahoma starting lineup offensively. A change on the offensive line. Wanye Morris is not available today, so Anton Harrison slides over to right tackle. Tyler Guyton at the left side. Marvin Mims over 20 yards per catch last year. He was the target on first down. Gabriel again. Quick set right over the middle, and he's got Drake Stoops. First completion of the Brent Venables era goes to Bob Stoops' son.
And we got a minor down right now on the ground. But back-to-back throws, I love that.
Right,
you script your plays. You come out with a shot that you just missed. Protection broke down a little bit. You don't get it. You come right back with that RPO to Stoops. You're going to see an awful lot of that. This is going to be a run-heavy team. They're going to pound the football. But I love letting the QB come out and sling it.
He's one for two. The injured party is Jadrian Taylor, the defensive lineman and all-conference USA guy last year. Mehule on the right side of the defensive end is also a sack machine over there, 15 and a half, fourth all-time at UTEP. Tyrese Knight, one of the two linebackers, a senior in that spot and a very important guy to them. Dennis Barnes takes over at that nickelback spot. Justin Prince is out for the first half after a targeting penalty in their opener. First run, Eric Gray, who's bulked up this year.
Yeah, about 10 to 15 pounds seeing him on the field in pregame, and it's good bulk. It's the kind that he needs to run between the tackles, which like that you'll see a bunch.
Gabriel snaps off the throw again downfield. Marvin Mims, they connect this time, and he rolls down to the 10.
You knew you were going to see this, a little vertical switch release there. You get man-to-man coverage, the Miners will play it, and they don't have anybody that can run with 17.
Yards on that from Gabriel to Mims.
13.
It's Gabriel darting inside. Oh, what a cut. Touchdown.
But we know he can throw it. He's thrown an awful lot of touchdowns. Not known for this element of the game. But in a one-on-one in the open field, he looks like that guy we watched Thursday night with those silky smooth feet, Spencer Sanders. Dylan Gabriel presenting that element to this offense. Look out.
His understanding, Brock, of this offense, considering the combination with Levy.
He's going to slow this game down. And for a team on the other side, UTEP, that's going to play so much man-to-man, it is a very brutal matchup.
Zach Schmidt, who replaces the fantastic Gabe Berkich. And the extra point is good. Well, it took a minute 17 for Brent Venables to have his first touchdown as a head coach, and it's his new quarterback finding his way in. By Progressive. One thing no one would ever challenge, protecting your home and car with Progressive. And by Edward Jones. Life is for living. Let's partner for all of it. The energy he would call uncommon.
Yeah.
Brent Venables, he loves doing. He is a doer. He is in the middle of it. He has Ted Roof, his defensive coordinator, covering kickoffs in practice. This is a moving stat.
I love what he said to us yesterday amidst about 100 things that I loved. But he said, I may be the new coach, but I'm not new here. He knows the brand, and he knows the style of ball these people want to see.
He's got a 7-0 lead, and here is Gavin Hardison. We introduce you to UTEP's quarterback, who is from the eastern border from Texas and New Mexico, out of New Mexico, Hobbs, New Mexico. At UTEP, 25 touchdowns, 18 interceptions. Last week, one touchdown, couple of misfires, but you like his arm, don't you, Brock?
6'3", 215. He's prototypical. He can hum it down the field. Coach Dimmel said, threw it 78 yards in a little competition in the summer. Hits a golf ball out of the yard. And a lot is going to be on his broad shoulders this afternoon.
For a UTEP team that was over 500 last year, Hardison's first throw is knocked away. Incomplete. Billy Moman jumped it for Oklahoma. UTEP's offensive line center is Andrew Meyer in his third year as a starter, wearing number 75 after a 400-yard week last week. They are going to be rather stressed. And Ray Flores, running back, wide receiver, we may see him do both. Hardison rolling, meets pressure, throws it back behind him, and that is incomplete. Reggie Grimes got in there to mark her down. It might have been Grimes coming up to Hardison and tossing him. Possible targeting on this. We will see. It was a high hit, but yes. No targeting.
Roughing the passer here. You know these guys are excited to get after it. I will be curious. The booth can review that if they, and then they look at every play. But that was late. That was near the jaw, and that drew a critical penalty.
Yeah, it's a first down from the 40 for UTEP, and a run for Ronald Awad. Jeffrey Johnson, the Tulane transfer, got in there first, along with Agwebu, the senior linebacker. And Oklahoma will run a bunch of guys on that defensive line. Johnson has played here before in a different uniform with Tulane after that game that was very close last season with the Green Wave to a 5-point score. Danny Stutzman, a big-time hitter at the linebacker spot. Deshaun White plays what they call the cheetah position, sort of a hybrid there. And Bowman on the backside already with a knock away and a Hardison pass. Second down, he pulls it out and throws, and a contested catch is grabbed by Kelly Akari, the redshirt sophomore JUCO transfer.
And there's Bowman once again, just eyes in the backfield. Like so many systems in college football, there's a run element, there's a pass element, and it really is on Gavin to make that read, and there you see some of the arm strength. I mean, that ball, you'll see it time and again. They are line drives, and they have to be because there's not going to be much separation. And these receivers, I think, have learned a lesson here in the first two attempts. They're going to get hit just about when that ball gets to their hands.
Dana Dimmel has plans to bleed some clock off here today. Oklahoma will go tempo, and this is Awad, and he is smothered. Jordan Kelly, the redshirt senior from Tulsa, at a loss of 4.
Yeah, he is right over the best lineman here for UTEP, and just watch this move, the quickness right off the snap. I love the pad level. Look at that. Rips right through. He's in the backfield nearly every one of these snaps thus far. All right, first little quick thumbnail sketch of Venable's defense, downhill. The linebacker stunt, these linemen are downhill. They're not stunting, they're not stemming, they're not doing what they did with Alex Grinch. But boy, are they coming downhill fast.
After a very physical camp before the season, we will get into throughout the course of this game. Hardison to throw, and it's incomplete through the hands of Tyron Smith, who had a big week last week, but it's 3rd and 14.
Yeah, and that can't happen. Tyron did have an enormous day, 200-yard receivers, in fact, for the Miners, the Flores. But he had 3 of those a week ago, including a dropped 50-plus-yard touchdown that could have turned that game. But that's a reflection. He watched the first couple passes and thought, oh, I'm going to get hit. Got to catch it first.
That's exactly what you said. People are feeling that contact even across the field. And now here comes the crowd. 3rd and 14. Hardison looking topside. Pressure comes. He gets out of it for a moment, and the throw is out of bounds. Jalen Redmond was the first guy in to make contact and speed that up.
Got a little line stunt, 4-man rush, zone behind it. Lots of different looks so far. Watch the Sooners up front on that defensive line. They're going to stunt. They're going to get right into the face. And as I said, there's going to be a lot on Hardison's shoulders today. Check with me, run pass options, and pressure like that. If you get 4-man rushing and beating your 5, you know you're in for a long day. Going to get hit at QB.
Back to receive. We've already seen a couple of punts blocked today from the 5. Mims is crushed after a 2-yard return or so. Dylan Gabriel spent some time at UCF, nearly ended up at UCLA, but he's here at Oklahoma with his former and current UWIN. Trey Young is here. He got a huge round of applause. Current Atlanta Hawk guard, former leading scorer for this team, and outstanding dynamic playmaker.
False start. Number 71, offense. 5-yard penalty, first down.
Trey Young, when he was here, would shoot from 35 feet, and they loved it at the Noble Center.
Where do you get that T-shirt, you think?
Somewhere that's a little pricier than you care to pay, I believe. Trey Young's got style, bro.
Yeah.
First down and 14, and it's Eric Gray. He gets a couple of yards. I wonder what the run pass is going to look like today for Oklahoma.
I think you're going to see a good mix. I think over the course of the season, it is going to tilt. Jeff Lebby was about 59% at Ole Miss. By the end of the year, you get closer there.
That is not going to make Brent Venables happy. A second procedure penalty forthcoming.
False start. Number 17, offense. Half distance to the goal. Second down.
Last three seasons, Jeff Lebby has had a top six team in total offense. Former UCF and Ole Miss offensive coordinator who went to Hawaii to bond with Dillon Gabriel when he first got him. Called him while Gabriel and Caleb Williams were doing the shape-shifting. Williams to USC. He got Gabriel here even though he had committed to UCLA. And this is a big run for Eric Gray. Down the sideline, Gray slams on the brakes and had Hilton skid by him. It's a first down.
Well, that's an excellent job. This has been one of the pleasant surprises in camp. Braden Willis did a terrific job on the touchdown. That time gets to the second level and paves the way.
A couple of nice blocks already. This is Mims. Catch and run. Marvin Mims weaving across the 30.
And here they go. Catch up, James. That's the only thing that's going to slow it down. You see the ball in the lineman right ready to roll. Not only top six offense in yards, but man, they run a lot of plays.
They snapped it before the chains were actually set. And Gabriel puts it right on the belly of Gray for a first and goal. Gray trying to hop outside, and second and goal coming up.
Wow, this is fast.
I mean, you asked Jeff Lebby, when do you want to snap it on the play clock? He says, we don't care what the time is. We just want to see continuous tape that's watchable on Sunday.
Yep, do not look at the play clock. Do not look at number of plays. Just know by feel that it's on the accelerator.
Major in for Gray. He won't get it. Instead, they pay off Willis, who had a big block earlier for the touchdown.
Well, that is about as easy pitch and catch as Dillon Gabriel's ever going to get. You're going to see the release here, the fake. Watch the linebackers. Totally blown and busted coverage. There is nobody home. And I'm going to have a sense that Gabriel's going to have a bunch of those gimmies this afternoon against a bunch of foes. As you said in the opener, he knows this system inside out.
Well, I'll tell you what, you said they're going to run the ball. They did. Gray got him out of the shadow of the goalpost. Gabriel for Willis. 14-0 Oklahoma after a couple of false start penalties. Gray's big run got him out of inside the five, and then Willis pays it off with the touchdown. A 93-yard drive and a buck 48.
Yeah, I think three Sooners are going to love this system even more than the previous one. Eric Gray, because he can run and catch it. Marvin Mims, because he's the fastest Sooner, most explosive. And then Braden Willis, kind of the X factor. Jeremiah Hall was so good in that position. But they have loved what they have seen from Braden Willis, tight end.
Won't be gone back at the five for UTEP. Helmet came off, and Dawn ends up at about the 17. And now Mims goes and is the helmet picker-upper as well. Back to that last drive.
Yeah, that was this explosive 30-plus yard run. You can see the added strength for Eric Gray. They utilize him out of the backfield, receiving the ball as well. Just a wide open. UTEP plays so much man-to-man coverage, and it is such a difficult matchup with all the new pieces they have on the back end of the secondary. And here is a play-action touchdown to Willis.
UTEP UTEP got it to midfield, but had to punt on its last drive. And here's Hardison on the roll, throwing back. And he does have a completion across the 30 for Tyron Smith. Hey, fans voted, and Wendy's and Fox College Football listen. Today's Wendy's Viewer's Choice Cam will be focusing on the trenches. Go to CFB on Fox on Twitter to enjoy this alternative view for the rest of the game.
I'll get used to seeing a bunch of line stunts. We've seen that already from OU's group up front. Going to see a ton of different bodies. Upwards of 14 for UTEP, 12 could play on that D-line for Oklahoma.
Akari came sweeping by, and he got drilled by Jaden Davis, who read it the whole way.
Yeah, he sure did. He sees that motion from across the field. That's the benefit of being a senior, having some experience under your belt. You're not just looking at the guy in front of you. Look at his eyes. He is seeing that zoom motion. He could tell that the receiver, well, he's in no man's land. He's hesitating. He's waiting. Davis pulls the trigger for another tackle for loss.
We heard in camp guys were flying around. That's what Deshaun White said, the linebacker. And there, Davis was flying around. Loss of six. Hardison double clutched it and then just had to throw it at the feet of Grimes, who hemmed him in.
That's just another heads up play.
Number one was in the area of the pass.
And that's back-to-back snaps, right? When you're coaching and you're implementing defense, as Ted Roof is calling it, Venables is watching the details, and Dana Dibble knows it. Like, those are two heads up plays from a corner, Davis. That time on the edge, Grimes, he sees the screen, he reads it, he gets in the throwing lane and forces a third and 16 with a crowd that's going to erupt.
They could install for week number one and how that would look. This is a defense that's very ready to go right now.
We talked about this last night with uncommon effort. And how does that show up? It's all over signage in the buildings. It shows up with count the number of helmets that come and make this tackle. I mean, look at them. One, two, three, four, five Sooners come in there in pursuit. That is exactly what that man is looking for.
Sloan's punt. Mims is back, and he gets hit. That was a fair catch, and it wasn't exactly the meaning of fair. Deshaun Trotter blitzed him.
Kick catch interference, number 19, kicking team. 15-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down, Oklahoma.
Frustrating start for UTEP. Oklahoma, it's everything they could have wanted. Effort on defense, big plays on offense. 14-0 in Venables first. Creating financial security for more than 150 years. And by Cadillac. Be iconic. Oklahoma's offense has gotten in quickly twice. The defense, which hasn't been in the top 20 in scoring defense since 2009, has played well so far to the tune of 19 yards.
Well, I think immediately an OU fan sees, you're not, like, all that pre-snap movement, you're not slanting and stunting and all this stuff, stunting yourself out of plays. It has been sound, they've been on the details and been dominant.
Quick hit for Stoops. A little carve inside, there's Stoopsing here at the old ballpark, and it's a first down.
And he, too, is going to love this system. They liked the previous one. It was super productive, but there's a few pieces here that are going to be highlighted more.
On the reverse, Gavin Freeman keeps his feet, breaks another one down the sideline. That is ridiculous.
How did he do that?
So, for a first game at Oklahoma Memorial Stadium, They're going to lift him up.
He's the easiest to pick up at 5'8", buck 70.
We got the Simba cam going on down on the sideline for Oklahoma. Man, the defense is swarming. The offense is sleek. And Oklahoma, in the blink of an eye, scores again.
You hear scouts talk all the time about contact balance for running backs. Here's your little slot receiver, true freshman from Oklahoma City. This epitomizes contact balance. Pirouetting right through two broken tackles, a quick stiff arm to the face. And I just can't imagine what that feels like. Right? Is somebody that grew up in this area, been waiting for that moment, and your first touch is that? For these fans right here, you just set the bar, Mr. Freeman. They want to do that cheer for you more and more. That was something.
I mean, you can't even dream it that beautifully.
All right, Dana's looking at that play sheet. What do we have?
Well, he's got 150 of them, he says. Through the back of the end zone, and they'll get it at the 25. Look, Dana Dimel last week was not happy with his team playing tight. And this might be, just microcosmically, you're down 21-0. Maybe this does help his team and loosen him up a little bit.
And you could see that. There were throws that Gavin Hardison just held a little bit. There were receivers that didn't concentrate. There were broken tackles. That's not this right now. And you're right. Now it is house money. Just go cut it loose. You've got nothing to lose, obviously. But this is just being physically overwhelmed by bigger, stronger, faster.
First down for Hardison. Giving ground again. Hardison pump fake and incomplete. Bigger, stronger, faster that looks proud of it right now.
Yeah, and just also along with those physical abilities, then just the keen awareness of being on top of details and coverage. Nowhere to go on that side of the ball. I love this. Reading the routes, recognizing what's coming at you, getting sticky in coverage and nowhere for Hardison to throw it.
And movement at the line.
False start. Number 79. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Second.
Yeah, trying to go the more conventional route. That's Klein, the right guard of that clap, right? They were using earlier, Dana Dimel said in the spring, they knew they were playing here, and they put in a silent count, a little more NFL-like, where the guard taps the center. I think down 21, maybe thinking we can go back to the conventional clap. But it catches them.
He claps for it, second down and 15. Hardison whips it wide, and that's Akari again, and there are three guys waiting for it.
Terrific pursuit. I've heard coaches call it the camera club. Defensive coaches will say, hey, are you in the camera club? And that's when the play ends on coach's tape, the last snippet of it. Are you in the club? Did you get on camera? Did you fly to the football? And they are right now for Venables.
There might be a wait list for the camera club membership right now. They rush four, nearly got there, and this is a broken tackle by Smith for a first down for UTEP.
It's maybe the first negative play defensively with a negative grade. You have the coverage, you're going to roll right up into it. You're going to see Jaden Davis is there like he was earlier. The route right in front of him, the tackle is to be made. One of the rare opportunities where UTEP gets the better of Jaden Davis and the Sooners to move the chains.
Very close there, but Smith did not scrape the ground with that knee. Hardison on first down. He slings it. A little sidewinder. And he got it to Flores. Little Dan Quisenberry for you.
He had to once again. You're going to see the cheat of Deshaun White right in his face. A baseball player there. Grew up. You pointed that out to the town to me. He's right on the border, New Mexico and West Texas. There's not a lot going on. His dad was a great baseball player. He's played a ton of baseball. That's the shortstop. And so many of these quarterbacks change the arm angle. That's beautiful.
Zakari in motion. They'll go with Awad, who gets absolutely turned around by Agwebu first, and Downs cleans it up.
Nice job by Jordan Kelly, just staying stout right in the middle of it. We saw penetration earlier, but he sets it. Look at his shoulders here. See how he stays. He takes on the double team. He fights through the double team, and that frees up those linebackers. Again, not stunting, not slanting. So much movement last year under Alex Grinch. Want to be a lot more stout and sound and let the linebackers run free.
Quick set right over the middle for a couple yards. Danny Stutzman on the back of Zach Fryer. It's third down. About three.
This is big for UTEP's defense. You gotta stay on the field. You do not have an answer for Brent Venables and that crew offensively. Evan Hardison knows it. They crossed midfield every single drive in their loss a week ago. But they have got to protect their defense by staying on the field.
Maybe go for it on fourth down if you don't get it here.
Quite possibly, especially if you can avoid a negative play.
UTEP takes their first charge timeout of the half, 30 seconds in late.
We've shown you Gavin Hardison a number of times. On the back is the last name Laufenberg, for his former teammate, a tight end back in 2019 named Luke Laufenberg, who spring ball as the starting tight end there at UTEP. His leukemia came out of remission. He passed away in August of 2019. Gavin Hardison wearing that jersey in honor of his fallen teammate. He has a hat that says "Live Like Luke" that he was wearing pregame.
False start, number 68, offense, 5-yard penalty, third down.
It's the left tackle, Zuri Henry, and there is Luke Laufenberg. Former tight end, and look, when you're going through something like that and you don't know if it's going to come back, the idea that your teammates in the future are pushing your name forward and making sure that how you lived and how you fought and how you existed still happens is a beautiful thing.
No question. Babeson has left an enduring memory in all of their lives.
Hardison pulls it down and throws, and did get it for Tyron Smith. And a first down. I mean, Hardison's talked about being a more of a leader in honor of Luke, and this is a big play right here.
Big time. Staying on the field, and look at that rope. And that is right by, that whistles by Deshaun White's fingertips. We've seen it three or four times now. I mean, he's got unique arm strength. I don't know what it is about West Texas and the state of Texas throwing in there, and Mahomes and others. I'm not comparing him to Matt Patrick Mahomes, but when you can throw it almost 80 yards, as Danny Dimmel saw him do in a competition this summer, that's different.
Got him a first down, and they'll cross the 40 with Awad. Second down and about five coming up. Agwebu was there on the stop.
That time actually a little stunt that stunted them out of a gap. And Awad able to take advantage. Agwebu was left alone there, the two D linemen in front of him, a little TE stunt. Nowhere to be found, and a good positive. If they can just get first down, positive yards. I know you hear that all the time. With an underdog as heavy as they are, it's critical.
Hardison, that was tipped at the line. Tyron Smith was the intended target, and it's third down. Justin Broyles came up in the safety spot.
We've seen this now three or four different times of guys getting in the throwing lane. Hardison was able to drop down last time, but this time the eye's right on it. Broyles so savvy to get the hand up. Create again a critical third and five, and this is four down territory. Can't have a negative play, can't take a sack, false start. But right now you're in four down territory.
They're two for two on third down in this drive. We got to get to the 31. It's Awad, and he is going to be about a yard shy. What's your play call here, Heward?
Everything is open to you, and that play call was because you knew that you were going to go for it here on fourth down. Dave Warner, Dana Dimmel, the two of them work in unison, calling these plays. Strength of your group, if you're going to run it, is your right guard and center. That smile, he loves that situation. He's smiling to see what his Sooners can do.
Fourth and one. It's a throw for Hardison, fading back, and no dice. Oh, a marker comes in. Maybe Thompson, the tight end, was held. Danny Stutzman in coverage. Referee Tutah Salam.
Pass interference, number 28. Defense. The ball will be placed at the spot of the foul. Automatic first down.
Stutzman, a talented young player, 6'4". He's right here. He is locked in man coverage. He does not get fooled. He's right in the hip pocket. There's just like that little contact right there. A savvy move from Trent Thompson, right? Like in basketball, you just draw that foul. Trey Young's in the building. He knows if there's contact, you just draw that foul. Big conversion.
Walls cave in. Hardison is doused. Reggie Grimes came from the backside and knocked him down.
Yeah, Grimes gets the sack. Jalen Redmond in the middle. It's his push that creates it. All effort from Grimes coming this way, but look at 31 in the middle. He's the one that forces Hardison out of that pocket. And your uncommon effort, you never slowing down, playing a lot of defensive linemen. That's a picture of that kind of energy.
Team defense to the core right now. The defensive line, especially for Oklahoma. Under a minute to go in the first. On the ground, and that is trouble. Grimes broke down the front door this time.
That time the stunt gets home. Jordan Kelly's right here. He's stunting. He takes two. Grimes comes around it. Again, details. Right on that hip. The fumbled snap, and it's the worst side a quarterback can see.
Reggie Grimes originally wanted to go to Clemson when Brent Venables was coordinating there. His window closed, the scholarship was gone, and he has the chance now to play for that guy here in Norman. Back-to-back sacks for him as the first quarter expires.
It's the end of the first quarter.
If you're a Sooner fan, how do you feel, Brock?
You know the answer.
There's your score. Echo. First quarter stats, 229-55. Time of possession, not that important today.
Not in today's college football.
Wow. You showed just the time of possession to somebody 40 years ago?
Yep.
They say UTEP's on 14. Not anymore. Tempo is the name of the game here in Norman. Third and 27 for UTEP. Hardison on the roll. He's going to take some yards and maybe set up a field goal try for Beckley.
Nothing there. That is just solid, sound defense. Third and 27. You keep your depth. Keep everything in front of you. I'm liking what I'm seeing. Just the details. And indeed, UTEP will attempt a field goal. That's what every savvy Sooner fan is going to want to see with Brent Venables. How's this look different? Where's the defensive detail? Where's the tackling? Where's understanding of coverage? So far, so good. 15 minutes in.
Brent Venables says he likes to get scarred up. He likes the grind. And we have seen a lot of intensity from his defense so far. Gavin Beckley, the senior, missed from 41, made from inside 30 twice last week, and this line drive kick is through. A buzzsaw over the crossbar, and UTEP is on the board.
What does Tiger call his two iron stinger?
Man, that's... Even got the lean from the cheerleader back there.
Yeah, that's usually the carb through the wind. I don't think that's exactly how he wanted to hit it, but you love the result.
21-3. It's 102 degrees here in Norman. Just snacking, taking in the ball game, enjoying. Oh boy, it's a little hot.
102. That was an hour ago.
Yeah, you know what?
Pushing 110 as she fans herself. I was amidst the peeps walking down on the field pregame. I hope sunscreen was out because it is toasty.
There's not a lot of shade here either. You're just in it here in Norman. A tremendous atmosphere for college football. Bowman back to receive, and he will take it out. To the 26. He gets a yard out of it. Dylan Gabriel so far hasn't had the ball for very long, hasn't needed to.
6-7, a buck 28. That's not bad. He was colorful. The Islander walking in. And you're going to see a ton of this. I mean, he throws as pretty a deep ball as anybody in college football. Not known to do much of this as a runner. 6 touchdowns on the ground over 3 years at UCF. But showing he is capable in that play action and that smooth. That Trey Young, he's got a smooth jumper. Jeff Levy said that is his greatest strength, man. No wasted movement, effortless, smooth stroke.
Loves the details of fundamentals. Gabriel line drive knocked away from Farouk. And it's second down coming up.
And he does not have the biggest rocket arm. He's a little bit like Tua, his counterpart, whose records he broke in the islands. His touch, his deep ball, all of that is awesome. He was easily thrown at 60 plus in warm-ups. But it's about his efficiency.
Marcus Major is slicing forward to about the line to gain. You think Gabriel and Tua look quite a bit alike.
Eerily similar. And it's obviously the lefty thing. Tua's thicker. Tua's faster overall, athletically, maybe a little more dynamic. But as far as that delivery and understanding ball and how to get the job done, off the charts.
The injured party is Jerome Wilson Jr., who's playing at linebacker for Breon Hayward, who is ineligible for the first couple games. So this is a very thin linebacker spot for you. The free-to-play Fox Bet Super 6 app. One of the questions in today's contest is how many total touchdowns will be scored in the game. There will be chances to win all season long, so download the app and play for free. One of the questions is not, how hot is that beard today? The answer is an 11, and there is a penalty marker on a third down and one that will no longer be.
False start, number 66, offense, 5-yard penalty, third down.
On Conjol, by the way, Jerome Wilson Jr., the linebacker who was hurt, walked off, and he's replaced by Cal Wallerstedt. Third false start penalty leads to a third and 6 and a tip ball by Tyreek James.
Boy, do they need that.
Maybe the rare double tip there, it looked like. Possibly Taylor, who was hurt earlier, came back in. For the first time this year, we learned the name of Michael Turk, one of the great punters in the land. And his boot all the way back to the 15. Marcus Dillon with a fair catch. Next Saturday, America's number one.
Yeah, traveling down there to Texas, all the new faces you see in the Big 12, Quinn Ewers. So highly thought of, one of the biggest recruits in the state of Texas. Didn't work out in Columbus. And what an opportunity he has against those Crimson Tide.
Gavin Hardison to throw, and he got it over the top of Agwebu for a catch for Tyron Smith, second down.
Ball whistles out of his hands.
Mm-hmm.
You watch him in pregame. You've said this a number of times about Hardison, and is why I always balk at people that say, oh, arm strength doesn't matter. And it's all about accuracy. No, arm strength does matter. And especially, you know, when you're playing a superior opponent athletically, you may be a step behind them, but his ball speed compensates.
Windows are tighter today, right?
No question about it.
Awat. That is a first down. White was sneaking up to the line there, and he got the first lick on him to drive him back. It'll be first down, UTEP.
But that's what you want. You want to run away from that cheetah. That's the position, the hybrid position that you're going to see here at Oklahoma. You're going to see some Harrington as well play that position, but you want to run away from that. An excellent job by Meyer and Klein, center and right guard, to get penetration. He's going to be fun in this system.
Mm-hmm.
And we've seen at Clemson with Venable, some of the different athletes he puts in different spots to run, and he's good enough to cover in the slot as well. Versatile.
Hardison to throw, and incomplete. Danny Stutzman was out there in coverage.
This is so good. And I've said this three or four times, but this is just not just playing a coverage. It is, I'm reading the QB's eyes. Okay, I've got to get out to the flat. I'm a zone player there, and it's 6'4", 240. Once again, to just have the awareness, not just on a whiteboard run a defense, but an awareness to get underneath that route.
Stutzman up to the line on the far side. Now he backs off into coverage. Hardison to the sideline, and Flores with a jumping grab at the edge.
I love this guy. He's a senior. He's done it all right here. Just a go route zone coverage. See little cloud coverage there. Eyes are all to the back. It takes a perfect throw with enough, again, horsepower to push that from the hash all the way to the boundary before the safety can get to it. And sticky fingertips there from Flores.
A mechanical engineering major who was third in his class in high school from El Paso, a local product. First down run for Hankins. That gets strung out for a gain of about two. This is the quietest the stadium has been. An odd hush.
Well, they had to punt the ball.
Are they going to be okay?
I don't know. Very disappointed. And UTEP is going to add to this time of possession, a stat that's meaningless in today's college football, but it's sure helping their defense.
Hardison threw it over the oncoming downs and got it to Flores for another first down.
Yeah, that's a beautiful job there by a signal caller that's been there and done it. The game's slowing down. The stadium's quieting a little bit. Run pass option. Watch him. Number two, you can watch me on defense. I'll watch you. Here comes the cheetah. And I'll throw it right behind that blitz. You hear all the time, you got to throw into the blitz. You do that because you get to actually see that pressure coming at you. You get to navigate it and put it right on number three's chest.
Out of the backfield, Awat in space, Awat out of bounds. Agwebu didn't have an angle, and it's first down, UTEP.
No, he didn't. That's a nice job once again of just outflanking, of leveraging the defense. Agwebu, big old linebacker, man, 6'4". He's actually cut weight. He's at 250. He's leaned up a little bit, but he's best between the tackles, so a good job to get him in a one-on-one in space.
Quick set, Flores again, ready to catch. He does gain a nine. Dave Warner, the offensive coordinator, this is a tough ask in week two, but this is their best drive.
Oh, and they did a nice job a season ago when he came aboard with Dana Dimmel. They've had over 300 yards of offense 15 straight games there for UTEP. Every game last season, 400 a week ago, but this was the problem. The problem was the red zone. 0 for 3 scoring touchdowns last week. It's why they lost to North Texas. Got to find a way to throw it in the end zone here.
Second and one, scanning Hardison, too much for Akari. And there is a marker flying in on the back end. Trey Morrison was back there.
That's the right call. There was a tug on the jersey you're going to see on replay. Discussion here, is that a hold? Is that pass interference? It is clearly a penalty because it prevented from Akari to go up and get that one.
You think it substantially impeded his ability to catch the ball, and it was catchable?
It's a good job of reading the rule book.
Well, I was asking a question.
Pass interference, number 6, defense. The foul occurred in the end zone. The ball will be placed at the 2-yard line. Automatic first down.
With all that language, this is what happened.
Some good speed with these receivers. Akari is flying by the junior college transfer. And the crowd may not like it. Kind of a welcome, to be honest with you. Kind of been a little bit of a lull, but that's absolutely the right call. And that puts UTEP in a situation where, there was a hold. You didn't see it. You get a few more looks than you do that one time on the field.
It looked like he was asking the officials to ask him. This could be the 9th play of the drive for UTEP. Trying to keep it close here. Second quarter, about 9 minutes to go. Hankins the tailback with Hardison. It is the freshman Hankins, and he is stood up and driven back. Nothing there. Isaiah Coe, Key Lawrence, etc. with the stop.
From Homewood,
Flossmoor
High School down in South Chicago. Someone familiar with that school in the booth?
You said it 6 times in Stillwater on Thursday. Thank you.
There you go, Mr. Coe.
The alumni folks will be reaching out to you for donations now.
You know Venables loves this stuff, though, right? I mean, these are the moments. You do all that hitting in camp, and these are the moments, the live bullets down on the goal line, where you really get to see the physical nature of your team.
That is what he lives for. Second down and goal. Hardison, the handoff. Touchdown, AWOT.
That was a heck of a drive. It was a terrific job by Trent Thompson, the tight end. James Tupou, the fullback, comes and gets a shot on Agwebu. Watch this here. In order to run this, you have to seal the edge. It doesn't start unless you seal right there, which he does. Tupou comes and gives a little kiss to Agwebu. And the Miners not backing down.
We saw it Thursday night down the road in Stillwater. Oklahoma State had a big lead. Central Michigan came back. This is a 5-minute-plus drive to get UTEP in the end zone. Ball is sponsored by Verizon, the network America relies on. And by Cerveza Dos Equis. Get a dose. Please drink responsibly. Sooner Schooners maiden voyage of 2022. And even from that high up, you could see that the best drive for UTEP was the last one.
Didn't drop the ball. And Hardison was awesome. I mean, he was effective. He threw it all over the field. He saw the pressure.
Billy Coleman got to the 26 last time. Cuts back inside, and he makes his way to about the 26 again. Brent Venables, first season back here at Oklahoma, a number of big names that he has been touched by in his career.
Yeah, a lot of continuity. Hasn't been a ton of different places. Played for as a walk-on, got a scholarship, and then coached for Bill Snyder. Was here under Bob Stoops 13 years. Then went out to place in South Carolina, won a couple national titles. We felt a lot of Dabo sitting down yesterday with Brent. I think he even said he learned how to love from the inside out. The players a little bit more, appreciate the players a little bit more. Certainly one of Dabo's great gifts.
Gabriel goes down. He saw the pressure coming, and it was Wallerstedt who swarmed him under a loss of five.
Yeah, he did not see a wide open crosser here. Man-to-man coverage on the perimeter, it was sticky. And there's a good look at Bradley Delpavito, the defensive coordinator, been doing it a long time, going to play man-to-man coverage. Big negative play on first.
Brent Venables, by the way, last 2 days has fielded calls from Bob Stoops and Dabo Swinney getting ready for this ball game. Gabriel launches down the field for Rook and too much. It's a third and 15 suddenly for Oklahoma.
It's become a big play at 21-10 if you can get off the field. You know what you're getting. This is the exact same play they ran earlier where he overshot. Very first play of the game. It was Mims that first time. It was Farouk. Those two guys this staff loves. Feels like they can really go after the sack. This is a pretty critical third and 15. Can you play zone? Can you keep things in front of you? That's the question here as UTEP will rush three.
Gabriel, too hot. Theo Weiss, the intended target. And this sports car of an offense has slowed down a little bit thanks to UTEP's defense.
Pass, pass, pass. I mean, that's the danger of passing it. A little surprise after 24 straight days of inside run from Brent Venables and Bill Biedenboe and Jeff Levy come out trying to throw it. Time and again, a little danger with the sack. Set that drive back.
24 days of inside run straight is very physical, you're saying, right?
Uncommon. Didn't happen in today's college football.
UTEP's getting it back. 5 minutes, 10 seconds on their last drive. 7:14 to go in the second quarter in a two-score game. UTEP gets it back. What do you like here?
I take a shot.
Hardison. Pressure up the middle. That faltered. He still had nowhere to go. And he is sacked. Agwebu finished the deal.
Yeah, that's the one thing you can't do. Momentum has turned. You get the ball back in great position. You try to throw it here. There's nowhere to throw it. Throw it away. You got to just throw this one to the bench. You can't take a negative play here. That's one of the rare mistakes for Gavin in the first half of play. That was not an O-line sack. That was a coverage sack. And as a QB, you got to protect your line by getting rid of that football.
Felt that pendulum sort of swing. It was a subdued crowd. And now off the fifth tackle for loss for Oklahoma. They're back a little bit. Second down and 20. Downs from the backside. Back-to-back sacks for the Sooners.
Gosh, this is really good coverage. I pointed this out a number of times. They're not just playing coverage. They're playing routes. Zone coverage. Look at 3-on-2 here. Once again, getting underneath the route. There is no place for Hardison to throw. Zone coverage to the field on the other side. Those are two terrific snaps of coverage. And a lot of negative yards here that, once again, you just got to throw the football away.
That yellow line is a long way away. Quick set on the bubble. It's going to get 2 yards for Walter Dawn Jr. And Oklahoma flies to the ball again.
You know, for years and years here, the offense, it's been the tempo setter. The offense goes and scores. The offense turns the momentum. That was all about defense. I mean, this is a game, an opportunity there for UTEP to make it one score with a field goal. And the defense comes out, terrific coverage, sack, sack, get off the field. And now it's going to set the opportunity up for the offense to get going.
See if Mims gets a chance to return this punt. Somebody was unhappy down there. Fair catch to the 32. Oklahoma feeling the momentum swing. The defense decided to get enraged. 21 sponsored by Cadillac. Be iconic. And by Liberty Mutual Insurance. Only pay for what you need.
That takes more than one day of practice.
Probably more than 24 straight days, too.
The team was doing inside runs. She was doing the baton neck thing.
And based on those last two drives, maybe an opportunity for Venables to tell his offensive guys, maybe Bill Beatenbow even whispers to him, let's run the football. Let's push these guys around. Good look at Bill Beatenbow. Continuity so key keeping him here.
There you go. Eric Gray on the ground for a couple of yards.
Get right back to it. That guy was an important hire. I know Jeff Lebby gets all the headlines, but keeping your O-line coach that's built everything here, huge.
They will run it again as prophesied, and he's got about six. It'll be third down and short.
I mean, honestly, this would have been, I think, an opportunity to just say, we're going to run it. But before we put that ball back in the air and in harm's way, you pound the football.
After back-to-back three and outs, Gray will not let that happen, just churning for the first down.
And now you go a little RPO if you want. And you kind of help set that up as we see a Sooner lineman coming off the field.
It's Tyler Guyton.
Remember, no Morris as well today at right tackle. Verification will come, I'm sure, after the game with that to some degree. So some moving pieces up front.
Major to midfield.
That's what they call a wham block. Braden Willis, the tight end, lining up in the backfield, coming across the center there. Paves the way.
It's Aaron Parks who's checked in at left tackle for Oklahoma, and again UTEP gets to Gabriel. Jadrian Taylor the sack.
And that was a terrific move, just a one-on-one, clearly beating the left tackle right there, a rip through. Five straight runs are effective. You go back to throwing it, you're sacked, and now you're looking to third along again.
Major on the backfield, stoops a block in front. Major puts the head down and finally gets finished off. Hilton was there, and it'll be fourth down. What do you got?
First big decision for the new head coach. First time he's ever made it, and I think you say go.
We hear the crowd reaction to the green light. Fourth down and two. It's Gray weaving for the first down and pounding his fist. Enjoy. That was just, we think we can get 2 yards from you.
This drive has been, other than the sack, this has been a statement drive. Again, if you want guys to be physical, well, you got to practice it. And they did it with one of the most violent camps anyone around here has seen in some time. And then if you want to establish the run, you got to do what you're doing on this drive. Call it.
Gabriel scrambling. Guyton did come back in at left tackle to gain a one. No turnovers yet in the ball game. Under 2 minutes to go, first half. Gray up the middle again, and he gets himself four or five.
Yeah, and this has been a lot of number zero, right? The initial contact that he's running through, he knew to sustain over the course of a season, sustain in the system, he had to add some power and some weight. You're seeing it on this drive.
Call it third and two. And Oklahoma willing to knock the clock down. UTEP does have two timeouts and the ball after halftime. Gray, nifty agility.
Look like all those drills those running backs do, right?
Mm-hmm.
In the hole, you can run through people. That time you run around them.
Over the top for Willis, the tight end. One man won't stop him. Touchdown. We heard the tight end might be active in the pass game, and he has been.
This is so good. And when you're a fifth-year senior, the whole key here is watch his patience. he knows his number's called. It's going to come to me, but I have got to be patient. I got to sell that I'm coming to the second level that time to block James Neal. I can't get grabbed. I got to get around him. And then the elusiveness to break the open field tackle and touchdown number two for number nine.
His first start 3 years ago was in the college football playoff semifinals. Willis now, with Jeremiah Hall leaving, has taken over at tight end with a capital T and a capital O. We're back in 30 seconds, Oklahoma by 18. Let's take a look at what's coming up at State Farm's halftime show. Top 25 teams battling today. Points aplenty in North Carolina. Mack Brown and his coaching start in Boone, UNC and Appalachian State, and then Michigan, and one of its two quarterbacks today.
Pretty crazy. Same game, college football. One game can be 63-61, and one can be 7-3 without a touchdown.
7-3 without a touchdown is really hard to do.
Yes.
It's like a Rubik's Cube in under 30 seconds. But they figured it out in Iowa City. Our Pacific Life game summary, sponsored by Pacific Life, creating financial security for more than 150 years. What stands out to you there, Brian?
Yeah, this is pretty good. You're going to win a lot of games. Obviously, the sacks play a big part of that. Total number of plays, not where Jeff Levy's going to want it, although he doesn't look at it and isn't told it. But they want that number to be closer to 80 to 90. And just 30 thus far, lots and lots of big plays, six of them over 24 yards for Oklahoma. And UTEP's got to be smart here. They get the ball to begin the second half. This is where I may be willing right here to run it and just get this game to the second half, knowing you get the ball to begin it.
Even with two timeouts. Hardison does throw. Oh, what a jumping grab over at the sideline for the first down and out of bounds for Akari.
It's a beautiful catch. These two had a tough time connecting a week ago in the opener. That is some serious hang time. That is defying gravity to go up and get it and just somehow, some way hang. Beautiful.
Quick slant. That's Tyron Smith. I get what you're saying, but I do appreciate the confidence in his guy.
Yes, but you just have to make sure they don't get the ball again. They've got all three. You got two, but they've got three timeouts. But now that you've crossed the 40, now it is go time.
Hardison to the outside, and another first down and out of bounds for Flores one more time in the arms of Stutzman with 25 seconds.
And you're also, this is a reaction, Oklahoma's playing it soft. Right, defensively, they're giving you these opportunities. They're not bringing pressure. They're not playing man. So they, too, have played into, I think, some of the decision-making here in the final 50 seconds.
7 yards, 8 yards, and then this one for about four. And maybe use one of those timeouts here. In fact, they will.
UTEP takes their second charge.
Marcus Bellum with the catch. Brent Venables waving his team over, who coached with Ted Roof last year. It was a non-coaching role for Ted Roof, sort of consultancy, and he ends up here as a defensive coordinator.
Yeah, and I asked him, just kind of point blank, as you see right here in the sunglasses, would he be here if he didn't have that role a season ago at Clemson? And he said, no, probably not. But just gained so much respect. A veteran guy that's been there and done it. If Brent's going to hand the card to somebody, for the first time in 20 years, he's not calling every shot. He wanted to hand it to somebody that's done it for many years in a bunch of different spots, as Ted has. And just a terrific staff. But I think experience, a former head coach, was so critical in that hire.
35 years in coaching for Ted Roof, who got his start as the laundry guy and the assistant coach for every team, and back here as a defensive coordinator. Second down and six. Hardison the throw. It's a first down for Flores, and now the possibility of field goal range dawns.
Yeah, now you got to get up and just spike it quickly. 13 seconds. Do not want to waste any of them.
And there it is. 2 seconds come off. Okay, one timeout, 11 seconds. You're right around the 35. What can you do here?
You can do everything. You got the timeout, so you can do anything at the 150 or so plays on that play sheet. But more importantly, it's what you can't do. You cannot take a sack right here. And there have been a few of those where the clock's been a little bit messed up for Gavin Hardison in that pocket. So more than anything, in the NFL, you can remind your QB, can't do that, no headset, that you cannot take a sack.
Second and 10, Hardison. Time ticking. Down he goes. Grimes, there it was. Exactly what you said couldn't happen.
Speechless.
Wow. College football, sponsored by Geico. 28-10, your halftime score. UTEP trailing Oklahoma in the debut of Brent Venables, head coach, in our first half stats, sponsored by Geico. The rush yards, obviously trouble for UTEP, but Brock Huard, I want to know, half number one of the Brent Venables era, where are you on it?
Well, I like the attention to detail defensively. A little bit too much grabbing. I'm sure that'll be the conversation halftime. Hey, avoid the negative plays and the penalties. The sacks were huge, obviously, defensively. But just the overall, I know it's a theme here. It's the effort. It's the energy. It's the aggressiveness. I thought many of those things shined. It will be a bigger challenge in the second half. It is hot. I think we broke our thermometer on
Looks
the field.
Like it.
It is just stuck at 110. So some of the folks in the stands have found their way to some shade. So they're going to have to create some of their own juice as UTEP will begin with the ball.
And off we go with the second half from here in Norman. Walter Dawn on the return. He gets the 19 in our second half connection. Sponsored by AT&T Business. AT&T 5G. Fast, reliable, secure.
Yeah, here's some of that just uncommon effort and energy to pursue and get to the football. 1.5 sacks there for Grimes in the first half of play. And this is a camera club that we talked about. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 Sooners all pursuing the ball. And then how fun was this for the true freshman? His first touch, Gavin Freeman, is a Sooner on the jet sweep. And yeah, you may have had a bunch of bodies around the ball, but you could not corral number 82 as he created a moment for himself, his family, his friends, and loved ones here in Oklahoma City. What a play.
First touch. Now Hardison over the middle, right on target, and it's Tupo, the fullback, for his first catch.
Don't see a lot of this from the big fella with the hair flowing out of the back of the helmet. We saw in the first half, 30 minutes of play, when Hardison pulls the trigger, when he gets rid of the ball. Right, 3 of the 4 sacks in the first half was really his clock, but when he gets rid of it, he can put it on the money.
Tupo, 4 catches combined the last 2 years. This one goes for 24. And a first down for Hardison. His throw is a little bit short for Tyron Smith.
A little short because of the cheetah. We have not called Deshaun White's name a bunch. And I don't think that's any fault of his own. He's playing a new position, that hybrid nickel position. And he's been outside the box a bunch, been a little bit more in coverage. But that time he's worked a little bit of the U off the sticker, I think. The contact maybe all through training camp as well. And that time he gets into the face and forces the low throw.
Smith in motion on second down. Play action for Hankins. Pressure coming again. Hardison gets rid of it. And Reggie Grimes one more time created that ticking clock. And it's 3rd and 10.
but a better job there of getting rid of the ball. And you know, after just taking points off the board with a sack late, that's going to be the point of emphasis in the second half. You can see there are three UTEP blockers, but it's that energy and that motor of Grimes, who is just not stopping or slowing down in this heat.
Danny Stutzman just turned to the crowd and started conducting them to get them out of their seats on a 100-degree-plus day down in the field. Stutzman came up, and the snap is a bad one. It's low. Hardison falls on it, and it's punt time for UTEP.
I think it was just hot as well. I think that's what threw Hardison off. You're going to see the blitz right in the center's face coming right on him. And that ball just did. It came in low. It came in hot. And that is not the kind of start you want to begin the second half.
What's the bigger trouble, speaking of hot, the bigger trouble, that it's low or that it's hot?
Probably the velo on it. You can catch a low ball, but when it's coming both low and hot, that's a challenge.
Fair catch for Mims. Dylan Gabriel in the first half, 8 for 13, a buck 63. What's your evaluation?
Yeah, pretty conservative overall. Just 30 plays, lots of big plays. There were a couple sacks there as well. I think Dylan will look at those with Jeff Levy and say, you know, I probably could have gotten rid of the ball on one of them. Lots of shots, lots of opportunities to push the ball down the field. I don't think that will change here in the second half either, as long as they see as much man-to-man as they've seen from the Miners.
Great, a tailback, carving and shimmying for a first down.
Yeah, I think what I would do is every time there's two safeties that are lining up in the back, like that snap on first down, I'm running the ball. Just run the ball. Now there's a single safety. You see that? They go to man-to-man. Now it's a chance to throw it.
And he will. Gabriel to the outside to Theo Weiss on his first catch. And second down and medium.
Because if this offense is going to go the way that it always has for Levy, everywhere he has been, it is the run that sets the table for the big plays.
It's a Gabriel run this time, and into the slide, right around the line to gain. He will get the first down where he started the slide.
It is a spread system. It's an aggressive system, but it really is, if you study the numbers, predicated on pounding the football first.
Gabriel loads up. That's a line drive. It's caught for a first down and more for Theo Weiss down the sideline to about the 25.
And you know that feels good. Just a game played a year ago. Missed the entirety of the season. The former five-star. There's your man-to-man coverage. And there goes the ball, by the way. Right to the ref, to the official, as quickly as they can to get the whole thing set.
Gabriel, a little pop pass, goes to the tight end, Willis. The center's taught to look to the sideline to see where the spot is.
Yep, and they are taught right away. They work on that just mechanically. They call ball mechanics. When they go back and watch the tape, as we see a Miner down, they don't watch just the coach's tape separated. They watch it continually to see how players operate, how quickly they get it to those officials so they can get the whole operation set.
That's Wallerstedt, who's down and injured for UTEP. So we'll step aside. Oklahoma cooking right now, up by 18. Switch today and see all the ways you could save. Brett Venables, the many faces of him in his debut.
A lot of smiles, huh? A lot of smiles. It's good opportunities for Venables just to learn about his team, and he likes this group. The buy-in has been tremendous. As I mentioned to you earlier, camp is physical, but the guys bought in, and I know he's loved taking in all this information on his players.
Gray straight up the middle, pushing and powering down to the 12.
And once again, that is Braden Willis leading the way. It was Jeremiah Hall that was the hybrid fullback tight end, but number 9, Willis, has really paved the way on a lot of these blocks.
Line drive throw, it's Farouk inside the 5. First and goal, Oklahoma. Tempo again, as expected, Gray to about the 1. Right back to the ball. Oklahoma rapping on the door, the first score of the second half. Gray hit and dropped.
Excellent job there by James Neal, playing for the injured Wilson, the linebacker there for UTEP, shooting the gap. A lot of bodies around that line of scrimmage, straight man-to-man on the perimeter if you want to take a one-on-one opportunity. Or is this a chance for Bill Beedenbow and Jeff Levy to just say to those big men, this is all on you. I am not calling a pass. Kind of a tone-setting opportunity.
It is Major, and Marcus Major is very close. He's in. The near side official says touchdown, Oklahoma.
What do they say in football, low man wins? Watch Major here take on two. Be his own blocker, and I got two. But look at him just uproot the defender right there. And knee is down, but the ball crosses the threshold. Big time power.
So Ted Roof, the defensive coordinator, when he was talking about calling plays, he said, major in your majors. Take what's good for you and use it. And for Oklahoma, with that power, they literally majored in major.
And that is a tone-setting drive, and I love what that says to your line and to your team.
Couple cracks at it. Gray twice, no. Major the third time, yes. 35-10.
Stone, Tom Rinaldi heading over there as well.
So the women's national team just before we hit air today as this kick is going to go to the 25-yard line. Let's take a look at Built for Success presented by Rocket Mortgage. For the playbook on home loans, Rocket can. Oklahoma Memorial Stadium, this is the 100th anniversary. Love the gridiron without the hash marks. And now it's become this. We were even talking to Dana Dimmel, who walked into the stadium for the first time in 6 years yesterday, to now the over 80,000 capacity. And he was pointing out things that are new here, and it's been every couple years, it seems like.
Well, when you win at the rate they have won and folks invest back into the program and you have 75,000 for your spring game, Dana Dimmel knows they got it going here.
That was the highest attendance for any spring game this year. This is tipped and batted away by Billy Bowman, who climbed the ladder in a big way.
Once again, watch his eyes. His eyes are looking right back to the quarterback as these defenders have all day in their zone coverage. And because of that, he has an awareness to go up and get it and nearly mossed with the Jordan glove right there. The pick.
He nearly had himself a palm pick. Second down, they'll run it. It's Hankins, a freshman, who took a big hit from Bowman, who was up there again. He said he lost some confidence last year after giving up a few. He's playing with a lot of it right now.
And I think he's at his most natural position. He's played a little bit of everything, as some of these defenders have over the years. But no question this year, he is their safety. He's not a corner. Played some of the nickel last year, but he has found his home, replacing a lot of experience they lost at safety. Put on display today his instincts from that position.
Stutzman goes with the motion. Hardison throws and does have the first down. That's Jeremiah Ballard's first catch, the freshman from Houston.
One thing to watch for Oklahoma this year. In the years to come, Brett Venables and staff is going to recruit game changers on the D-line. That's what he had at Clemson year after year after year after year. And Grimes has been terrific. His motor has been relentless. But being able to get home with four consistently, that will be something to watch this year before they replenish that group with even more talent.
And a marker comes in.
It's going to be the right tackle flinching Jeremiah Byers, I believe.
False start. Number 63, offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
started every game last year at right tackle. Some experience there.
Yeah, they've gone away from the tap to the center. It's not nearly as loud as it was early in the building, so they've been utilizing that clap, and I think they're just... Hyman don't like that in my life experience.
Why?
They don't love change. Just, we're going to do it this way. But when you kind of start to mix it up for big fellas like that, they usually, and you've seen it, they flinched a time or two this afternoon. They don't like it.
He gave it the little sleep sign there. And they'll run it with a hard hit. Awad off the spin. Bowman came up again to meet him.
Yeah, these two backs for UTEP, Hankins and Awad, big part of why they went to a bowl game a year ago, their best season in a decade in El Paso. They're not going to hit home runs for you, but they are going to have some very loud singles and doubles. And just two big backs that are not afraid of contact.
You're big on moving the runner over in a game like this?
I like home runs more, but those singles and doubles is chewing this up, which has been key for their defense.
Second and 8. They'll go again on the ground, and this is Awad, who's dropped by Agwebu, who's been very active today.
You'll like this play.
I'm going to?
Brent Venables will like that play from Agwebu right there, the former linebacker himself that sits and shuffles and then strikes. Right, that was some good textbook drill work right there from Agwebu. He feels that outside run, and he just slides right with it. When it's time to strike and finish, he does.
Hardison over the middle. He once again has Ballard, who is driven back. So we'll see. They're going to say he did get the first down at the 50.
And that time again overcomes a snap that's a little bit low. And he's trying to have his eyes. Watch. He doesn't even look at the football hardly. He's trying to get his eyes down the field so he can see, right? Where is that pressure coming from? Is it just zone coverage? And if so, I got to get the ball out of my hand quickly. And, yeah, these snaps have been a bit of a challenge.
That was a generous spot, Brock. Safety pressure coming. He read it perfectly and found Smith, who got clotheslined by Bowman. And a marker's in.
There's a pulley marker on the hip. Count play. Holding tackle.
There's no foul, so face mask on the play. The tackle is legal. The second down.
I think that is the right call. The hands come up, and he does not grab the face mask, and then it goes below the face mask. So I think upon first look, and that's a terrific job by the crew to get together and talk about that. That happened quickly. But there was no grab. It came up, did it for Bowman to the face mask, but then slid down and brought him around the neck.
We're getting agreement from Mike Pereira from inside of our studio, who's watching the game and joining us today. The UTEP after that game goes on the ground to Hankins.
I think Mike knows in my next life I'll be an official.
That's what you're going to choose for number two? It's a tough job. Yeah. It's 110 degrees for them, too.
It is, and they're doing a good job. But I love that early. I love those guys communicating. It's easier. Remember I told you before half, Hardison doesn't have that speaker in the headset. Mm-hmm. Right there, Dana Dimmel can't communicate with them. All those officials do, though, now. And I think that has sped things up so they can talk to one another while they're meeting as a group and making those decisions. Good job by the officiating crew.
About a 5-minute drive now for UTEP. And they will keep it on the ground. Awad just gets pile driven by Stutzman. Whoa.
Remember that low pass?
Oh, yeah.
That wins. Hankins is 228 pounds as well, and that is called stopping power.
Stutzman's talked about how linebackers are the foundation for Brent Venables and the honor it is to play linebacker for him. There's nothing there for Hardison over at the sideline. Woody Washington used the paint very well there.
He did. And I like that point. Danny Stutzman, a guy last year banged up a little bit, but they loved him a season ago and said, look out. Because when this guy gets experience, he's just different. He's 6'4", 240. And you know I love to ask these coaches about violence and who hits the hardest and who busts face masks. And I try like every possible question I can to get answered. And when they don't hesitate, and Ted Roof didn't hesitate, Brent Venables doesn't hesitate, 28's the guy that brings the stinger.
Hardison, little wobble and incomplete. Akari had to wait for it, and it's fourth down.
And it's wobbled because it's tipped at the line of scrimmage, and I think it's Jalen Redmond that gets his hands up. Awareness, awareness, awareness. Right here in the middle, the hand goes up. He, too, has eyes on the quarterback. And that doesn't look like much, but that's just a feel and awareness that we've seen across the board at every position group on that defense today.
Play number 12 of the drive is a fourth and six. Hardison whistles it wide and nobody home.
Well, that's the kind of drive. It goes for a while, but you get the stop, and the defensive guy's going to love that.
Football on Fox. First down, Oklahoma. Major had the touchdown in the last drive, and he's got a first down carry here.
And it was majoring in the run game, right, really since halftime, as they've come out here in the second half in the heat trying to wear down this crew.
Second down, nice read by Gabriel to the outside off a block again from Willis for a first down and a gain of 13.
You had him at UCF. Do you remember him running this much?
Not as much.
And this is a gimme, right? He sees the safety pressure coming down. Hilton, the safety, an easy pull and read.
There's a lot, I feel like a lot more bubble screen type stuff and things like that. And this is another dimension of Dylan Gabriel. Who, there's a great story in OU Daily by Mason Young about his relationship with Jeff Levy and how they bonded over a walk in a ravine behind the Gabriel family home. Major has a ravine to run through to the 20. First down, Oklahoma.
What a great job by left tackle, left guard. That's why the ravine was created. Look at these two big boys, double team. Safety Hilton now has to honor the QB. Right, last time he went right to the running back. That time he's in between, and Major with the big run.
Quick hitter from Gabriel. And Theo Weiss keeps his feet. There are too many white jerseys. Jeff Levy, the offensive coordinator, who again, Dylan Gabriel was going to UCLA. It was like the day before classes started, and Levy said, can I talk to you for a minute? And then the partnership, which was forged in Hawaii, has made its way to Norman. And Gabriel to throw it down the middle is a marker down. It was picked off by Johnson, it looks like. And we're going to have pass interference. It was Elijah Johnson who dove in to pick it. It's going
pass
away.
Pass interference. Number 32, defense. Half the distance to the goal. The 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Yeah, that is a lonely place with a lot of grass to cover. That's a little bit tough, but once you put your hand around the waist, we see that. We see the triggers from those back judges, right? You kind of have that contact to use that hand to propel him in front for the pick. That's a tough one. Would have been the first for the junior college transfer in his career here at UTEP.
Instead of a pick, it's first and goal. Gabriel to throw. That ends up somewhere in the Oklahoma City airport. And it's second down and goal.
That's a little look over, right? You're looking to the sidelines. You get the play. And then you're trying to see the coverage. And once you see all those guys lined up straight across the board like a fence, pretty good idea you're going to get man-to-man coverage. But do not win. And smart play. Heads-up play to throw it away and live for second down.
Major driving toward the goal line. Touchdown. That was a loud.
Yeah, it was Danny Stutzman, a linebacker with the stopping power on the other side. And you could see the inverse of that. There was no stopping the churn and power there. That's a guy they've been excited about. But academics injuries have just stalled a bit of his career. He couldn't get momentum going on the field. And he's put on display here on tape the kind of tools that he has.
He became eligible in October of last year. Came in with 3 career touchdowns. And that was a powerhouse score for point number 41.
Yeah, a lot of coaches talk about tackling issues week one. We didn't hear that yesterday. Not with the kind of camp they had, not with all the physical contact, not with all the loud hitting. And that's not been an issue for the Sooners today.
42-10 in the opener for Oklahoma. Says he wants demanding relentlessness and he wants people never to be satisfied. How about right here? That'll do it for you, right?
Yeah, that's not an easy chin-up bar either, right? You see his buddy there holding it in place. That's some serious strength, power.
There are easy chin-up bars.
Yeah.
I have never encountered one of those. Show me next time.
That's a new problem.
That certainly is. There's a lot of intertwining with these coaching staffs. And we go back to 1994 at Kansas State. Brent Venables and Dana Dimmel on the same staff.
And look at that neck. And look at this stash.
Oof.
That's what I see. I see a neck from a former walk-on from Kansas that earned a scholarship there. Not quite the neck. Still jacked. Still in great shape. And Dana, I think, went a little more goatee. More hip.
He
the
did.
Old stash.
He looked in that photo like a match game contestant back in 1994. But talking to Dana Dimmel about Venables, he said our personalities could not be more opposite, but they got along great as Hankins is driven down by Ellison.
And what a tree for Bill Snyder, who they both said, yep, we'll probably get notes from coach if he's watching. And he'll do the handwritten notes, which he's done so long, and give us both some counsel and some advice. And I think for Coach Venables, maybe some of the penalties has bothered Bill Snyder. He's got to love the effort of Dana Dimmel's guys to not quit. But too many sacks on that side of the ball to really get any positive momentum going.
Dana Dimmel also suggested Bill Snyder might use a dictaphone for the notes. Old school. Hardison to throw. And not a whole lot there after the catch for Tyron Smith. Third down and long. They played Aquarius at halftime. That's another one bites the dust. It is the classic hits today here in Norman, and we have seen a number of them from the Oklahoma defense. Third down and 9 for Hardison. He feels pressure again. Sprinting out of the pocket, and he throws across his body for Smith, and there's that arm strength from Hardison.
That thing is smoking between 3 different zone defenders. Just a 4-man rush. I like this plan today from Ted Roof and Brent Venables. They've not done a ton of things. A lot of just fundamental base coverage stuff that just zone. And that was all Hardison extending it, those eyes. And then again, that shortstop man whipping it back across the infield. He has made some tremendous plays, and Ted Roof knows that's just better quarterback play.
Haywatt on a first down run into the teeth of that defense for a gain of about three on first down. A couple weeks from now, Oklahoma and Nebraska in a very interesting ball game, considering the difficulties for the Huskers in week one and this week against North Dakota. Hardison reaches back and throws it to the far side for Akari, who does have the first down, but he paid for it.
Yeah, you get a little feel here for just the philosophy of week one for Oklahoma, and that is, hey man, we play our coverage. We're going to play a lot of our base stuff. We don't need to show the world. I mean, if you were to compare and contrast for Dana Dimmel, what he would have faced, a Brent Venables-led defense at Clemson, all the inventory, all the experience in years. This has been very base defense today to just come up and see the guys finish and tackle, which I said earlier, they've done pretty well.
Haywatt dodging to the 40. Dana Dimmel described the schematics as brutal, quote unquote, that Brent Venables can throw at you when everything's installed. Well, you see the base of the defense as you're talking about with the effort today. 42-10 on a sunny day in Norman after three. Welcome back to Fox College Football, sponsored by Geico. Beautiful, sweltering day for college football from Norman, Oklahoma, and the Sooners in the opening game of Brent Venables' head coach tenure, up by 32. Hankins, the freshman, finds his way to the first down line. Danny Stutzman again was there to fill the gap. First down, UTEP. So Brent Venables, you talk about what he's done as a college coach. He's been a part of eight national championship games. His second year at Oklahoma, 2000, Josh Heupel and his team winning the national title, the most recent one for the Oklahoma Sooners. And the hope is for a place that really isn't used to coaches leaving, that he can bring back that feel of Oklahoma football that they're used to. This is wide and incomplete. December 5th, he was at the Alamo Bowl. Bob Stoops certified him after that Alamo Bowl win, mentioning him, and obviously they are close. What do you think is the headline best skill of Brent Venables?
Oh, it is his just defensive acumen. He is just so advanced, and Dana Dimmel talked about that. Ted Roof, who've been around for decades and see the best doing it, and they recruited incredible talent and developed it at Clemson, but it was his scheme that was so difficult.
Hardison flushed from the pocket. Throws in too high, incomplete.
You know, and it's a delicate situation when you come into a place and you're replacing a coach and you never want to get into, well, they didn't do this and they didn't do that and there were all these issues. And that was not the case in our conversation yesterday, but it's the little details, and it's on the defensive side of the ball especially. He's going to lean on Jeff Lebby and Dylan Gabriel and all that experience offensively to score a bunch of points, and they will. But what he wants to build back is just that intimidating level of defense so that when they get to the college football playoff, which they've been two, three times, they can compete on that side of the ball, which has not been the case for the last decade.
Flores was down over on the sideline. That's why the stoppage here. Brent Venables was asking that same question as you were talking about him. And so they have Flores up now, and we'll go back to play. So this was known for offense here in Norman.
Yes, and Alex Grinch did his part, right? They tried and they did a lot of stunting and moving, and they brought talent in and some, you know, very talented players at all three levels. But you know what they didn't do? 24 straight days. I keep coming back to that. 24 straight days of inside run. That's no receivers. That is linebackers and running backs and tight ends and the Lions just in collision after collision after collision.
Third down for Hardison. Looking near side, pressure coming. He got away from Redmond and this into gridlock, tipped by Stutzman, and it's fourth down.
How many tips have we seen today?
A bunch.
I mean, it's got to be nearing a half dozen from corners, linemen, linebackers, getting in throwing lanes. Just having a feel and an awareness. And look at Stutzman, man. That to me has been the biggest image through 46 minutes is the eyes of these defenders on the other side. So they can react and make a bunch of the plays they have today.
What does that tell you about teaching and where they are defensively?
Yeah, they're coming, and it's basic today, and it's, you know, little steps against an inferior opponent. Positive first foundation.
Beckley from 54 drives through it and puts it through. He's amped and rightfully so. 54 yards. Hey, look. You're a kicker? That's how you do it, man. Fox College Football is sponsored by Pacific Life, creating financial security for more than 150 years. Time winning his coaches at Oklahoma, Bud Wilkinson and his timely trousers for back in the day. 145 victories. Lincoln Riley leaves after 55 wins, and that didn't sit very well with a bunch of people here, considering the longevity of all those guys like Perry Switzer and Bud Wilkinson and Benny Owens.
The pride that this place has in their seniors.
Hey, look, there's a reason to have pride in this program. It's been 23 consecutive years that Oklahoma at some point has been in the top 10, including right now.
That's extraordinary. Maybe there's a reason he said no to so many other opportunities and overtures from other schools. He knew that eventually this one may come open. I don't know if he knew it would come open in December or any of us saw that coming, but when it did, he pounced.
Eric Gray out of the backfield does turn it upfield, and once again, Willis is right there involved as a blocker out on the edge.
Yeah, he's the X factor to me. He's the one in prep for this game and everything else that they just raved about internally. And they don't really have his backup. Daniel Parker's not played today. He's more of a blocker. Willis can do it all.
They haven't gotten the ball to Mims for a while, so they're going to do it. And there's Willis on the other side. Eric Gray was out in front there, too. First down.
Yeah, everybody has known his prowess as a pass catcher, and he's pretty good in that phase. Played off of Jeremiah Hall, but, yeah, he's doing a lot of cool stuff today when you watch this film and all the different things asked of him.
He's a graduate with an economics degree, Braden Willis is. Gabriel to throw down the middle, tipped and nearly picked off. Justin Prince, who sat out the first half after the targeting penalty, was closest.
Good job. Once again, they don't deviate much. They're going to continue to play man-to-man coverage. The hand there of Barnes on Stoops' shoulder, and those are the little plays that they needed today. Those takeaways just have not been a part of it. Got to Gabriel with a couple sacks, got him off the field a few times, but not nearly enough.
No turnovers each way, in fact, as that is just flat-out dropped by Jahlil Farouk. How long do you think Gabriel stays in, and when would you take him out?
I think if he converts here, they go down and score, I think that's about it. He doesn't need a ton of reps in this system to get comfortable with it.
Having played in it at UCF, if you're just joining us, it is Gray, and he is wrangled down at the 47-yard line. James Neal again deep in that linebacker depth chart for UTEP. The injury to Wilson, Hayward ineligible. And so punt time for Turk and Oklahoma.
Foundation for Oklahoma. And that receiver partners is Marcus Opponent.
Bellin back to receive. And he puts it on the ground, gets sideswiped, and then back on top of it. That was a scramble for a moment. UTEP will have it when we come back. Dylan Gabriel's had a nice debut with 42 points. It was an electric scene outside of the stadium before this game. The anticipation, you could feel it for this debut. Even on the field before the game, the walk with the players, arm in arm, Brent Venables to a drumline here in the stadium was empowering to the fans. As UTEP has Calvin Brownholtz checking in to play quarterback for the first time today. The redshirt junior out of Carmichael, California. His father, a former center at Georgia. His uncle, the ex-NFL quarterback, Billy Volek.
And he could spin it, too. And I think this is a reflection that Hardison has done all he can. You're not going to win this game. You want to keep him upright. But Calvin knows it. Been here 5 years. Knows what Dana Dibble came in with. Dana Dibble knows what he's asking for. He's played in now his 32nd game for the Miners.
He's been a short yardage guy at points. Second and eight. His throw is a little low. Jeremiah Ballard does get there. Back to the defense for Oklahoma.
Well, this theme is all over the building, and we have seen it shown up in a number of ways. Effort, relentlessness, intensity. Those Sooners swarming to the football. Boy, this was a good one. That is going to be teaching tape for uncommon effort. You get knocked down, you get back up, and this is teaching tape on form tackle from Danny Stutzman.
I guess I'm thinking about Brent Venables saying he's at his best when he's grinding. And this team is molded in that image. On a third and four, nearly intercepted over on the edge by Justin Harrington, who left Oklahoma, went into the transfer portal, thought about leaving, came back as a walk-on.
You're going to see him. He's going to back up Deshaun White in that cheetah position. But there's going to be games this year, maybe more pass happy opponents, where you're going to see him a little bit more on the field. Yeah, you're right. Walked away from it, had to come back as a walk-on. He's earned the respect of this staff.
Sloan's punt. Mims still in. Give him one more chance to return it. And Mims will take that chance, diving near the 40-yard line. Let's see what Oklahoma has in store for its next drive, starting in UTEP's field position. Up big, and time now for Above and Beyond, sponsored by Jersey Mike's. Be a sub above.
Pretty good balance. Pretty good opportunities for Eric Gray, rushing it, catching it a few times. It's fun to see Major get involved. You'll see more of Marvin Mims over the course of the season than just three opportunities. But when he got him like he did a year ago, big plays follow.
And a new quarterback for Oklahoma after Gabriel's day, you saw. It's Davis Bevel, the former backup to Kenny Pickett at Pitt. And he hands to Gray for a first down run.
I think Davis, an example in this system, when you think about Baylor, the 2010s, when you think about UCF and Ole Miss, you can come in different shapes and sizes. And Jeff Levy will play to your strength. Not all of them have been dual quarterbacks and some guys that just sit in the pocket and sling it like he does as a 6'6" guy. We have seen more with Dylan Gabriel's legs than I think maybe any of us anticipated coming in. But this is a system that can be molded to the different skill sets of the most important position in sports.
Out of Greenville, South Carolina. Another handoff, and this is Javonte Barnes, the freshman. The ball came loose. And let's see who's got it at the bottom of the pile here.
That looked like a true freshman run.
Really on the field of the fumble recovered by the offense. It's first down.
It is Oklahoma. And the injured player, Colby Hilton. The safety, Colby Hilton. Yeah. And it was the guy who made the hit, Hilton, who is the injured party, went in hard, lowering the shoulder.
Fox College Football is sponsored by State Farm. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
So we're talking during the break about the run by Barnes and the crowd of the helmet rule that is one of the options for targeting,
which you never see called on an offensive player, ever. And that was the crown of the helmet. That even in the new rule and everything, that's the top of the helmet that he drove right into the defender, and you just never see that called.
Barnes again on the run. The other rule is about defenseless player and forcible contact to the head or neck area. Crown of the helmet can be called on anybody, yes, to anybody.
And by the way, when I said that was a freshman run, Barnes, first carry, mid-season enrollee at spring ball, was awesome. Super excited the fan base is about him. But he got in the open field, and instead of making, I promise you, in the years to come, and they'll watch that on tape and go, you know, you can make a move. Right? I know you're in the open field and you're fast, but in the years to come, the game will slow down and you'll make that guy miss and you'll be in the end zone. But that time, just a heat-seeking missile to contact.
Yeah. Pedal to the floor. You're laughing because you've seen it so many times.
Oh, freshman, absolutely.
Let it go. And he bounced off a couple guys for a yard. That was Tyreek James, the safety up there. Third down, Big 12 is completely up for grabs, some might argue.
Well, I don't think there's any doubt about it. I think you can make a case for the team we saw Thursday night in Stillwater with their group defensively. Baylor, you can make a case for. These guys, you can make a case for. Can it turn at Texas? They're going to have an opportunity next week with Alabama to really see where they are. K-State returns quite a few people, his old school. They're in Manhattan, and those guys come. They've always played Oklahoma tough. They've come here in a few weeks.
Bevel keeps it, breaks it down. There's a flag in. Some want to there from Davis Bevel, but we'll check the marker in the middle of the field. It's Conjol coming off the field, hurt.
Sooners helmet popped off.
Personal foul. Illegal hands to the face. Number 94, defense. Half the distance of the goal. Automatic first down. Number 66 may remain in the game since his helmet came off due to foul.
That doesn't feel good.
Didn't look like it, Brock.
Nope.
The penalty moves the ball down to the 7-yard line where it's now.
He wasn't having any of it, though. Conjo was still blocking.
You'd expect nothing less from a guy that's been in Beatonbow's system for a number of years.
Ready to go. Barnes. Touchdown. If it stands, there's a marker back at the 11.
That's going to be a hold. Left guard Bird.
Number 59, offense. 10-yard penalty. First down.
Well, they just fired the artillery behind the goalpost, and they're going to maybe want it back.
Yep, this one's pretty obvious right here. You get that outside run going, you get a hold. It gets handsy in there. Those big fellas.
It's 110 degrees down on the field. It's a sticky atmosphere down there. And look at that. I mean, we at least, you know, it's not the heat. It's the humidity is what people say. Sometimes it's actually just the heat today. Thank you very much. The temperature gauge doesn't go any higher.
No.
It's like an extra innings in baseball. When you get to the 18th, they just start using the previous innings again and wipe them off the scoreboard.
But you know what is so savvy is who's in the sun? Those visitors. Who's been in the shade for most of the second half? The home team. It's called home field advantage.
Mm-hmm. Under 7 to go. Look. We're big fans of big fans. Gonna run it again. Tawi Walker with his first carry. They're high on him, too. Walker, the walk-on transfer from Palomar College.
Now, this has been our third opener doing Nebraska Northwestern. I got to say, in our three different openers, this is the loudest. And that's the fourth time we have heard from, and we are up here in Norman, Oklahoma, in this press box, that we have heard those pads just clashing.
Hello, everybody at home. That's our perch up here. Yeah, there's a crackle down there from the contact.
It's up. Let it go.
Third and goal. It'll be Walker again, hopping down to the five. We go for it here. Just to run a play, see what you got.
You may want to get your new field goal kicker some more. See that operation?
Zach Schmidt, 1-for-1 in field goals last year behind Berkich, and this will be from 22. And it is good. 45-13 Oklahoma. See those national championships for the Sooners. These are Big 12 titles, 6 in a row. Baylor beating Oklahoma State last year. And now, I mean, look, Oklahoma's 9 in the country. This is a great showing so far. But this Big 12 is a grab bag this year.
Yeah, and it's got some talented big people. Right, Baylor, talked to some of the folks on staff there. They got a lot to replace in the skill, but their big people, as they showed a year ago when they won the whole thing, are difference makers. Oklahoma State's front four, they play 12 deep. They're difference makers. You always say that about the Big 12. So you see Conjul, after getting his face ripped, heading to the locker room.
I have a business idea for Oklahoma, if we can, with 5:17 to go. What if they let the Schooner be available for ride share? So you'd click the button to get a ride share, and instead of just a regular sedan, you'd get the Schooner here on campus.
Oh, on campus.
Yeah,
outside.
Just
the
in this general vicinity here on campus. Since Brock was willing to be the angel investor on that, 0%. We'll take a look at our Pacific Life game summary, sponsored by Pacific Life, creating financial security for more than 150 years.
Quite a bit of run today. Run in some different varieties, about 18 different run concepts, according to Jeff Levy, within this game plan this week. Some QB runs, some jet sweep. Willis, a couple touchdowns, but one of the difference makers today, and then just the raw power. You know that guy who used to stick his face into all those collisions at Kansas State. He's enjoyed the physical nature of this game today.
You don't want to overvalue a first non-conference game, but just atmospherically and the way this game has felt, to me, it seems like it is in the mold of Brent Venables.
Yes. Yeah, and there's still big plays, right? In the very first play, or the first decision Brent Venables made was, I want the ball. So he made that clear, and the script was written, and we're going to take shots, right? And they came out throwing it deep and taking shots. But as it's evolved and as that's gone on, it's been a lot of running. It's been a lot of hitting. And that is what he wants to bring, that brand of ball back here.
Brown Holtz slings it near side, and Jeremiah Ballard has a first down and another driving tackle, this time Harrington.
And it really doesn't matter who, and we've seen a bunch of depth play on the D-line and in the secondary. And that was two Sooners again, right there on the tackle, helping their buddies out.
First down throw, Walter Dawn Jr. out of bounds at the 49. Well, there was a moment in that second quarter when UTEP provided some serious resistance. This was an 11-point game, and had that drive at the end of the half been different without the sack, this could have been a two-score game at the half. Another run for a first down for UTEP. And this is Torrance Burgess Jr., the sophomore transfer from Tyler Junior College.
Yeah, UTEP doesn't feel too dissimilar to Central Michigan that we watched the other night.
You think?
Just as far as Dana Dimmel's been here 5 years. He likes his team. He thinks they can get back to a bowl game this year, which would be first time in a long time, decades, if he can indeed do that after winning 7 a season ago.
Brown Holtz is dropped. Isaiah Coe
from
the south suburbs of Chicago. Brock,
we saw him early, and the big fella has gotten some run over the course of all 60 minutes of this game, just right in the middle. Go ahead and put that on your effort tape once again as well. Uncommon effort.
Isaiah Coe, the second most famous alum of Homewood Flossmoor High School, to our spotter, Adam Doster. Second down, 18 for UTEP. Brown Holtz to run.
But like Central Michigan the other night, I'll finish that point. They could have rolled over. It was 51-14 or whatever it was. Like, oh my gosh, here we go. And they didn't. And they battled back and they kept battling. UTEP in this matchup and all four of them with Oklahoma, it's not been competitive. It's 56-7 on average. But you saw them continue to compete, put some drives together. Artisan did a nice job throwing the ball and extending plays. And I think a bit of a statement that while overwhelmed in depth and overwhelmed in speed, they know who they are 5 years into Dimmel's program.
There's a lot of positivity around that program with a sellout in week one. And this, another rush and a hard one at that from Oklahoma. And Jared Kanick, the four-star prospect. Hey, next Saturday, America's number one
of a program that knows who they are down in Tuscaloosa more than anybody else in college football.
Fourth down and 9. Nicely threaded through to Ballard. Nice catch.
Great throw. Combination of the two of them on fourth down here. It's an out route to the sidelines. You see the underneath coverage. You got to throw it over through contact. That's what I'm talking about. Just depth of players here. You're into some depth for UTEP as well, and you're able to function. And Brown Holtz can come in the game and move the team and operate at the line of scrimmage.
Design roll. Brown Holtz to throw, and he's got it right there on target for another first down for UTEP with under 45 seconds to go. That's Clark with the catch. And Kent State is in here coming up next week, fighting Antonio Gates's. And then at Nebraska, which is growing in intrigue by close game after close game for the Huskers to start the year.
And that K-State team that is dangerous, Deuce Vaughn.
Adrian Martinez as well, the transfer from Nebraska. Intercepted in the back end for Oklahoma to put a capper on Venables Day number one as the head coach, Gentry Williams, the freshman from Tulsa, has a big first day as well.
How about these freshmen getting a chance to make their mark? We saw it early. Gavin Freeman telling his other freshman buddies, hey, we can make plays out here too. Kanick, the big hit. Venable's first recruiting class, freshman getting out here. Devontae Barnes into some collisions and making some memories. First time out, they'll never forget.
Brent Venables said to us yesterday, look, 60% of these guys decided to stay. You know, 40% of these guys chose to come with me.
That's right.
But a bunch of these guys decided to stay. That's right.
Yeah, they didn't pick me. I wasn't their guy that they committed to. But they stuck around, and the 40% that are new, like that hug right there with Bevel and others, and all these freshmen, pretty good day. Pretty good foundational day all the way around for Brent Venables.
As a baseline, everything you could ask for the Oklahoma Sooners. And you see how the players react. See if a smile cracks across that face for the head coach of Oklahoma. Brent Venables gets win number one as a Sooner head coach over UTEP, 45-13. There's some joy across the face. The new head coach. Your thoughts on Oklahoma today over UTEP?
I thought they played not vanilla. All right, they showed their stuff. Dylan Gabriel, there's a lot of confidence and trust in him. But defensively, it was about assignment, alignment, and then cut it loose, man. Just go let it rip and finish and tackle. And not many missed tackles for those guys in red today. So for a defensive-minded head coach, pretty good start.
45-13, the final score. From here in Norman, for Brock Heward, our entire wonderful crew, Bo Garrett, Darren Foster, and everybody downstairs in the truck, Jason Benetti saying farewell. We'll be back with more post-game coverage from Los Angeles right after these messages. Oklahoma by 32 for their new driver.